This week's episode of Talking Simpsons is brought to you by Geek Fuel. Go to geekfuel.com/lasertime to sign up for a box of geeky goodies sent to you directly. And if you sign up through geekfuel.com/lasertime, you will get an exclusive Star Wars item worth $20 added to your first box.
Ahoy hoy, everybody. Welcome to Talking Simpsons, the Laser Time Podcast Network's chronological exploration of the Simpsons. I am your host, as always, Bob Mackey. Who else is here today?
Christopher Antista.
I'm Henry Gilbert. Hi.
And today we'll be talking about the Season 2 episode Old Money, which aired on March 28th, 1991. And maybe Chris can tell us what happened on this mystical day in history when there was a new Simpsons episode.
Oh boy, Bobby. The Black Crowes topped the charts with Shake Your Moneymaker while being kicked off as the opening act of ZZ Top's tour. IBM unveils a $6,000 laptop, and Kevin Costner wins an astounding amount of Oscars, including Best Picture, for Dances with Wolves in the 63rd Annual Academy Awards.
Is that one of the worst Best Picture wins of all time?
I think it is, yeah. It's like a three-hour-long film about the white savior complex.
The noble savage.
Oh, the noble savage! Yes, that's exactly.
That's what it was about. And I left the movie theater, and I'm like, what, 10 now? And I'm just, I remember, Dad, all I can do is think about this movie. I think that means you liked it, son. I did. I couldn't stop thinking. I thought it was the best movie I'd ever seen, so I was totally wrapped up with it. I'm afraid to watch it again.
This was the start of a bad era of Kevin Costner films, where he's like, he had too much power.
Inexplicable era of Kevin Costner films. Prince of Thieves is the most unintentionally worst thing in the universe.
The sleepiest Robin Hood. The sleepiest, most American Robin Hood.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
Share money.
And that the late Alan Rickman just steals the film just by, like, not giving a damn. Yeah. Like, he's just like,
Costner's at like 1 and Rickman's at like 13.
Yes. And then somewhere, and there's Christian Slater at like an 8. Well, yeah, I'm part of it. Merry Men.
Who does he play?
Like Will something?
Yeah, the Robin of the group.
He plays someone who's not in the Disney version, therefore I don't recognize.
He plays medieval Jack Nicholson. No one could tell. I do want to say, Chris, we should get this out of the way. Do you have your death jingle at the ready?
Oh boy, do I ever.
We have at least one death in this episode.
This is true.
Death stalks you at every turn! There it is! Death!
So the death for today's episode is Audrey Meadows, who plays Bea Simmons, Abe's girlfriend for Old Money. And she was the wife on The Honeymooner. She played Alice. And
Brandon.
I don't mean to speak lustfully of the dead, but Alice was a total babe.
Yeah.
She was a hot tomato back in the day.
Yeah. I don't know what Ralph Kramden had on her. He had to have pictures or something.
He became famous for threatening a hitter.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the start.
That's true.
It is the beginning of the ugly guy with pretty wife trope of television.
Yeah, like
sitcoms were doing it too today.
It is such a carbon copy of King of Queens now.
She died 20 years ago.
Like February 3rd.
And I was trying to look up information on her. Thank God she has an official website that has received very few updates over the last 10 years.
Well, who's going to do it, Chris?
It still says on the front page, be sure to look for The Honeymooners every day at 12:30 on TV Land, featuring its first logo and not realizing it's Home Improvement and The Lopez Show now.
As a kid, I didn't know The Honeymooners. Like, I didn't know that that's where she was from. Also, she apparently was one of the few people that made a ton of money off the show other than Jackie Gleason.
She had her residuals in her contract, and it was like, it's only 40
episodes. Her
brother
was a lawyer.
It was only 40 episodes, but they aired for so long, and we didn't have cable growing up.
Basically 4 decades, and then they finally stopped re-airing.
And I remember I was pushed out of my house and into my friend's house. I'm like, why have my parents make me come over here? Because your parents are watching The Honeymooners. And I'm like, I hate The Honeymooners. Good, I'm glad I'm here. Not realizing it was code for my parents needing a night of fuck time.
Wow.
A night of fuck time is what I associate with the funny...
That's quite a euphemism.
Yeah, that's what it was for me. When my parents would say, we're going to watch The Honeymooners. I'm like, ick, I'm going to go to Brett's house.
Well, Abe Simpson got some fuck time in this episode.
There's a surprising amount of ribald jokes in here.
There are. We should talk about what happens in this episode. It's basically about Grandpa finding love.
It is.
This episode tries to redeem Abe Simpson, but as we've uncovered through many episodes, he is
he's a terrible
human being.
Just in the Herb episode, he's terrible.
Mostly, the Herb episode just happened, and he mentions, I only have one son. Mm-hmm. Abe, we just learned you have two sons.
I
know production.
It could be this episode where we get the name Abraham Simpson. I don't think he was given a first
indeed.
Name.
Yeah. That's another long story I've heard from Matt Groening, but the short version is that Matt Groening named all the characters in the immediate Simpson family after his family. His dad is Homer, mother Marge, sister Lisa.
The only difference is brother Brad is Bart.
Yeah. Mark is Bart.
Oh, how is Brad?
When it came time to name Grandpa, who was on the show in the shorts, but he was just Grandpa Simpson, he said he was not going to name it after his grandfather, Abe Simpson. He was like, nope, I'm going to let you guys name it. I'll just leave. Comes back, they're like, well, we thought of a good old man name for him, Abe Simpson. And Matt Groening says he just shrugged his shoulders like, it's fate, it must be.
It's a living being a billionaire.
It is a perfect, like, biblical old-timey name you would never hear today.
Yes, it's a nice Gus name, a World War II era name.
It's rather Amish in some cases.
What does Grandpa smell like?
That's a good question.
Grandpa kind of smells like that trunk in the garage with the bottoms all wet.
Nuh-uh, he smells more like a photo lab.
Stop it, both of you. Grandpa smells like a regular old man, which is more like a hallway in a hospital.
Homer, that's terrible. That. We should be teaching the children to treasure the elderly. You know, we'll be old someday.
My God, you're right, Mark. You kids won't put me in a home like I did to my dad, would you?
Well...
Ah! Marge, what do we do?
So, like, it's the episode is also a Homer redemption arc. Because the whole time he's trying to...
To a degree.
He's trying to be a better son to his father. Mm. That is his motivation the whole time.
At least for part of the third act.
No, no, or, even in the middle. Because remember,
act forward.
Yeah.
After the funeral.
No,
but
right after this. Because he shows up immediately after this.
Oh, that's right. He's like, no, we're going to have a good day.
Yeah, we're
going to
have a great day together.
So this, for a long time, was the lost episode for me. Because we taped every episode in the Gilbert household, and I mean every single one, except for this one. And I don't know what happened, because I think we went on... It was the first time we'd taken a vacation trip on the day a new episode of The Simpsons aired. Mm-hmm. Because from then on, I was checking TV Guide. Like, I remember the Herb Return episode.
Yeah.
I knew it aired in August. I was like, we got to time our VCR to record it or something. Like, we're going to be in a... We're on vacation this week, but we got to record it. This time, I think we missed it. And so I eventually recorded it when it aired in syndication during season 6. So if you put in our season 6 VHS, or one of them, all of a sudden this episode comes up. Though that also means,
because it looks really rough compared to...
Well, there's also multiple jokes in this that were cut for syndication so that I didn't know. Like that exchange about the smell of Grandpa, that was cut in the syndicated version.
Oh, really?
That's why I really enjoyed it. I couldn't remember that joke, and I actually identified with it because last night I was out at my favorite pizza pub just writing, and I smell something. Like, what smells like a musty basement? I look over, there's a table of old people who just appeared. I'm like, and then this morning I watched the episode. I'm like, it's a trunk in the basement.
It's, if you can keep clean a pair of 1,000-year-old clothing, they just have to smell like that.
Yeah. But I was like, am I smelling you aging? What is that? But yeah.
Taking Abe to the liquor store is a pretty shitty
Shitty deal.
Yeah. And he gets like a piece of jerky every time. So it's like one drawer in his bureau is just like all jerky.
I mean, take him to the grocery store at least. Why the liquor store?
We meet in the episode Beatrice Simmons. I like their 70-year-old meet cute.
Now, Mr. Simmons, don't make me call Nurse Bronski.
It's Simpson, damn it! And these aren't my pills!
Excuse me, nurse. My name is Simmons, and I think I have the wrong pills.
I get 2 red ones for my back spasms, a yellow one for my arrhythmia, and 2 of the bluest eyes I've ever seen in my life.
Then these must be...
And I have your...
They must have...
So this coughing is less funny when you know Aubrey Meadows died from lung cancer.
Yeah. This is the kind of, like, I feel like our generation's old ladies won't sound like this. Like, this is a real Doris Grau, like, whiskey and cigarettes
but
voice.
Will they have tramp stamps, though? I wonder.
Yes. Oh, that'll be so gross. They're all going to have no fear, thorny tattoos.
That term is gross. I'm sorry I said it. But I did.
It's ass antlers. That's the non slut shaming.
I just got fascinated with reading about Audrey Meadows, that she was headed up a banking organization in Colorado after a while, and she somehow before she died, somebody made an... She has an official website. It's still up. Somebody's still paying for this.
She was an active lady. On the commentary, they talk about what a great guest she was. She's telling fun stories.
Yeah.
And I also wanted to give credit to, like, Dan Castellaneta does amazing in this episode, because he'd... He's number one playing Abe the longest he's ever played him before. This is a grandpa showcase, the first one ever. And second, he is doing an old man voice next to an actual old person. And he's kind of like keeping up with her. And you're not thinking like, oh, this is a man in his 30s pretending to be old talking to an old woman.
Yeah, and it sounds like they're recording together in a lot of cases. Yeah, especially even with the whole family in the car later. It sounds
just
to finish my anecdote and tie it into The Simpsons, I'm on her old website. And I'm sorry, this is Schadenfreude. I like to delve into because of my life, click around and see what works on an ancient website that hasn't been updated in 12 years. And there's her books, her memoirs, the DVDs for the Honeymooners. And I click and they link, it says it links to like celebrity. I think the URL, I'm like, this isn't Amazon, but it looks like something, some place celebrities hire to manage their URLs in the early 90s. And like, so where could this possibly go? And I click Steve Allen store. Steve Allen. Once again, entering in The Simpsons.
Yeah.
But that would have been a Simpsons joke. Steve Allen celebrity store.
What was
website
he selling
store.
There? Like Steve it Allen. Was, like,
I think
masks.
It was just he probably put his name on the first online store for celebrities to help them manage things they couldn't.
Yeah.
Wow.
I know this internet a little better than you.
But this is Bee's intro.
I'm Beatrice Simmons, but my friends call me Bee.
Well, I'm Abraham J. Simpson. Care to tip the wrist with me?
I would be delighted.
Dude, I gotta say, their pill courtship is legit disgusting.
It is, and it actually is a parody of a movie scene that is
still
equally
have never
disgusting.
Seen this film.
Yeah, this clip is on YouTube. If you look up Tom Jones' dinner scene, it is a scene of two people eating like giant greasy banquet food sensually. So they're trying to go for the same effect. Apparently, Tom Jones was like this acclaimed comedy from 1963 that I've never seen.
Oscar, not a sex machine yet.
No, different Tom Jones.
It was a British production. It did win Best Picture this year, as I recall. It starred Albert Finney. The only thing I knew about Tom Jones was that when they cast Ewan McGregor to play a young Albert Finney in Big Fish, they wanted him to look as much like Tom Jones era Albert Finney as they could.
Oh wow, damn.
Yeah.
And I love this clip of like this should be rewarding. Abe trying to ask B out and just kind of coming to the conclusion that this is never not awkward.
And what are you doing tonight?
Sitting alone in my room.
Oh, well, you got plans already.
No, what were you going to say?
Oh, nothing.
Oh, Abe, you were going to say something.
Well, I was wondering if you and I, you know, might go to the same place at the same time. And geez, you think this might get easier with time?
I'd love to.
I haven't had to do that in a few years, but that never doesn't suck, kids. Remember.
I did enjoy his Lucky Lindy's pomade. never fly solo again.
That might be my favorite joke.
I think it's the smartest joke that just kind of flies by.
It's very dirty. It's also funny that two episodes ago it was Oh Brother Where Art Thou, and now pomade. I came to know what pomade was through Oh Brother Where Art Thou.
I just bought some to manage my J.J. Abrams-esque pubes growing out of the top of my head.
So that's what it's for.
Oh, we also get exposure to the Larry Davis Experience right after that, and this I at least found out from the commentary on this one what they are. They're the name. Larry Davis is the name of a teacher of either Jay Kogan or Wolodarski, one of the two writers.
So they were playing in the.
They're playing at the dance. Well, they were first, I think, in the flashback. No, they were at. They were on some Enchanted Evening, the Babysitter Bandit episode. They're playing at the hotel.
And they were playing at the prom in
The Way We Was, and which we'll get a call back to that soon too. But the dance scene was cute. It was probably the first time I'd ever seen a love montage like that as a child. So it probably felt new to me. Same with the very cliche of, oh, we met a girl in Act 1 who will be dead by Act 2, which is a very... It's been used in a million sitcoms and dramas and all that stuff. But the song Embraceable You, I wonder where that was from. I like that song, and it's a jazz standard that got famous in 1930s, recorded by the Gershwins. Wow. Made famous by Ginger Rogers, Nat King Cole, and Billie Holiday.
I don't know. There's some kind of... This episode filled me with a weird pop culture melancholy of like how young it felt like all media was. That television wasn't that old. Here's like the first famous television personality on The Simpsons. Seriously.
Yeah, here's Milton Berle. Here's all these
people. And I don't know. All that stuff.
They're all dead.
Well, we grew up in an era where most people who were on TV were... The first TVs were still alive.
Yeah, it is weird, like, the generation of old people The Simpsons is mocking throughout these early episodes. They're all basically almost dead, if not completely dead. It's like the greatest generation.
Dead. We have a jingle for it.
Going back to the beginning, where I remember watching that as a kid and seeing the joke about, oh, what if your parents got old and you have to take care of them? Now, parents are aging. Like, I have parents approaching 70. It's scary now. They're taking care of themselves. They're fine so far, but... I mean, will I be in the Bart and Lisa situation too?
That's just that you're watching David Boy and Alan Rickman dying like a year older than my parents.
Yeah, it's heavy. It's
oh,
heavy
God,
dog.
Wait. Okay, how about
Let's
more
Let's move on to more distractions.
We should get to Discount Lion Safari.
Discount, can I please go to stop by? Because this is like the last time Abe is still friends with Herman.
Oh, right. I think it's like Herman's last appearance before
his last
the Pulp Fiction
appearance.
Reference.
Yeah. He's so lightly
22
used.
Short stories about Springfield?
That's right, yeah. Season 7.
This is a great exchange.
Herman, a very special lady is having her birthday tomorrow.
Ah, the Battleship New Jersey.
No, you idiot. My girlfriend B. And since this is the only store I know...
Oh, Grandpa, nothing says I love you better than a military antique.
That kind of person is dying too.
Yeah. I mean, the kind of guy. Now when I look at Herman, I think, I bet if you gave him a certain wink, he'd sell you the Nazi memorabilia.
Yeah. He'd be the guy from Falling Down.
That's what I was thinking of. Yeah. It's like,
they actually used these, man.
Yeah.
I also smile on Bob's face that we both know that scene so
I've
well.
I've seen Falling Down a lot.
Yeah.
I did like the Grandma's World aside. It was just such a quick moment. Like, yeah, go to Grandma's World. I don't think they've gone there. I bet they have gone
they
there.
They lingered in that store for like 3 seconds. There was not even time to make a joke. Went to Grandma's World and got a shawl.
I did want to comment on how many in this episode, at least, saving grace, how many Hank Azaria blue-collar workers there are in it. There's like 17.
Oh, right.
It's
yes.
Like five in a row in
Price
this one.
Chick.
Well, that
Price
guy, chick. They even drew, it's the same guy who said, two grapes. Now he's a cashier at this place.
Hank Azaria is Charles Bronson-esque angry cashiers.
Homer at this point was wrong to think Grandpa was senile and thought he had a girlfriend, but by season 4, Grandpa is like the most senile Phoebe in the world. His joke is just he's almost dead and he is crazy.
Yeah, I think it's like they got rid of Herman because Grandpa was just a joke machine after this. He did not have a life of his own.
This is kind of one of the last... I mean...
He dates someone else later on.
Well, when he get... Yeah.
Season 14?
Occasionally they'll do that. Remember when he had sex with and married one of Homer's Vegas wives? And he said the thing, you're going to let Abe back into the Oval Office?
Okay.
That's
season 10 or something?
I think it's probably.
Discount Lion Safari
is
one of my favorite things. Just that the name Discount, it's just, fuck, I don't know. It's a great joke I never picked up on.
And the thing is, like, this is the worst idea ever for a business. And it's still happening. And dumbasses are still getting killed.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Like, people are stupid. They don't know this giant lion can actually rip them apart. And, like, I think the last one, last known, like, fatality was in 2015.
Yeah, drive-through zoos.
Yeah.
It's got to be a dying art.
No, I know.
I love reading about dead...
harder to find.
When I try and go to sleep at night and I can't, I read about dead theme parks and like all of these places from the 60s and 70s drive in and up to our elephants and our lions and like we're out of business, hang up the sign, let's take off, and like you can see like skeletons of elephants.
Bye,
and
elephants,
like,
they just
left them there.
They'll take care of themselves.
We're no longer culpable. It's not a business anymore. What is up, Talking Simpsons fans? Chris here, briefly jumping in to tell you this show is brought to you by Geek Fuel. And if you go to geekfuel.com/lasertime right now, you can get a free Star Wars item worth $20 just for signing up for a mystery box. So what's in the mystery box, you ask? 6 to 8 items, an exclusive t-shirt, and a $50 value of Kit and Caboodle featuring famous stuff from Marvel, DC, Nintendo, Zelda, Game of Thrones, Pop Figs, pint glasses, posters. You never know quite what it's going to be, but it's like a delicious geeky gift that shows up at your door whenever you feel like it. And guess what? They've had Simpsons stuff involved in the box in the past. So go to geekfuel.com/lasertime right now, sign up for one of their boxes, get it as a gift for a geek in your life, and get a free $20 Star Wars item right now.
Yeah, I think the Discount Lion Safari is another one of the things you'll see in the first few seasons where the writers who grew up in the 70s are excising their demons or just remembering things like, oh yeah, I remember that when I was a kid. Let's put that in here.
It's amazing such a bad idea has persisted for at least 50 years as a business.
Also, I timed it. By the time Abe meets B, the day after their last trip, it's now the next third Sunday of the month. So they had only been together a month.
A month.
Yeah.
Because I was curious about that. They made it seem like years.
That's what a montage will do, Trisha.
My line of the show is in this segment. I don't know if you have a clip or anything, Chris.
Which one's that?
It's Bart saying, hey, did anyone notice this place sucks?
I did love that line.
It's such a blunt, like, just punched in the face joke. Just like,
this place sucks.
Yeah.
No, I just have him return, like, Abe returning. This would fit well into a traditional sitcom. It's very classical, jokey.
Out of my way! I got a date with an angel!
You don't know how right you are, Abe.
What?
I'm sorry to be the one to tell you this, but B passed away last night.
Oh, no.
It was her ticker. The doc said her left ventricle burst.
Oh, no, Jasper. Amy says she died of a burst ventricle, but I know she died of a broken heart.
Yeah. That's kind of a joke.
That sounds like James L. Brooks.
It does.
Yeah.
It does.
You can kind of pick those out. They're a little too clever for their own good, you know?
I feel really bad for B that she died on her birthday.
On her birthday, when her man didn't show up.
Actually, the line that comes right after that on the break, that was one of my favorite ones. Like, I can tell she really cared for me. She didn't make me a pallbearer. And just seeing these old men carrying the thing, like, that is still an anxiety I sometimes have in public of, like, when just last night I was at Walgreens just buying milk or whatever, and there's this old man who's just living his life buying stuff, but I just see him, I'm like, what if he died right now? Oh, no. Like, he's just trying to buy food, but he can't carry all this stuff. Like, it's just this weird anxiety I have.
Are we at the funeral now?
We're at the funeral.
For me, we have Grandpa Simpson disowning Homer.
We do.
I can't tell you how sorry I am, Dad.
Is someone talking to me? I didn't hear anything.
Oh, no. Dad's lost his hearing.
No, you idiot. I'm ignoring you. You made me miss the last precious moment of B's life. I'll never speak to you again. I have no son!
Okay. This is one of several references to the Jazz Singer. Scene in the Jazz Singer.
They did it a million... Yeah. I mean,
especially in the Krusty and his father episode.
An entire episode is the Jazz Singer.
And this podcast is about deep cuts, so I'm like, why does Abe, like, rip his shirt?
Yes.
I had to look that up,
apparently,
too.
It's a Jewish tradition when you hear someone has died. That's, like, a part of the bereavement process. Like, you, like, rend your garments. So, like, he's saying, you're dead to me, so he rips his shirt.
That explains a lot of movies.
But Grandpa Simpson is not Jewish, but it works for the reference.
Well, that's exactly what Laurence Olivier does in The Jazz Singer, the awful Neil Diamond Jazz Singer.
Of the 81? I saw a clip of that. Today.
Where he says, it's named I Half.
FF.
FF, no son.
Half no
son. So he doesn't tear it enough, but I read about the production of that film, that Laurence Olivier was like, I will do no ads for this. I will do no interviews. You'll get me, and I'm out, and you pay me a bunch of money. And he was right, because he knew Neil Diamond acting against Laurence Olivier, the greatest actor of his generation, versus a 70s pop singer, like, the worst.
Weird, that's the only version of the movie that's online that I can see clips of.
Yeah,
I didn't see any older clips.
That should be on, like, go to, like, the National Registry or
that's
something.
That's, like, the first talkie, right? Officially?
It was, yes. Yeah.
You ain't seen nothing yet, folks. But Abe ends up... Here's a weird conversation. Abe ends up inheriting money from B after their month-long courtship.
From who does he get that news?
It's not who he gets it. I wanted to talk about the denomination, but...
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It was a beautiful service, wasn't it, Mr. Simpson?
Who the hell are you?
Lionel Hutz, attorney at law.
Yay.
I'm the executor of Beatrice Simmons' estate. Mr. Simpson, B was a wealthy woman, and surprise, surprise, she left everything to you.
Really?
There is one catch. You must spend one night in a haunted house. Just kidding. Here's a check for $106,000 to enjoy as you see fit. Oh, I'm touched.
$106,000?
Ta-ta, Mr. Simpson. By the way, old-timer, I do wills. Why don't I just give you this pen with my phone number on it? It looks just like a cigar. Isn't that something?
Lionel Hutz was not editing video wills in his favor
no,
yet.
No, yeah, that's... Yeah. I was just about to say the same thing. I think this joke fell slightly... I love seeing Lionel Hutz again.
Oh, yeah.
But it fell slightly
But that's his whole
flat.
Appearance.
But it fell slightly flat for me because, yeah, when he does the video will of Marge's aunt... He says, like, you'd be surprised how many times that works. You really would. Like, he's This isn't him stealing money.
He's not sleazy enough, and the thing about spending the night in a haunted house, it's happened two more times on the show. Yes. Bart the Fink opens with that. They have to spend the night in a haunted house to get their money from an inheritance, and it's the best sleep they've ever had.
Yeah.
And another episode ends with them sleeping in a haunted house. I forget which one that is, though.
That's Homer in Loves Flanders.
Oh, that's the haunted house one?
Yeah,
because
that's when it proves
like, next week on The Simpsons.
They're like, I hate you, Ned. See, it's back to normal. I have this day in this haunted house. The writers love referencing how hacky a haunted house joke is.
I love it. It works all three times.
Yeah, meanwhile, I don't see any movies with haunted houses anymore, and I'm bored out of my mind.
So do you know how much money $106,000 is worth today? I went to an online inflation thing. So it is worth $185,000 today. $1,992 or $91.
Doesn't seem like enough inflation.
No, it feels like it should be worth more than
you
that.
You can buy more video games with it today.
Yeah. It just surprised me how low the numbers seem for like someone's entire... Because he said she was very rich.
Yeah, but she wouldn't be in a home if she was very rich.
Like, I think my neighbor makes $106,000 a year. Like, yeah. We live in San Francisco.
We have people in this episode falling over themselves to get this money. Like, the nursing home director is basically offering to give a hand job to Abe Simpson.
I did notice a couple dirty jokes in newer episodes of The Simpsons, and they strangely all come from Grandpa.
Hmm.
Like, he makes dick and erection jokes, and strangely he's the target or the center of most of them.
I think
here.
That makes it more palatable for like a censor, like, oh, it's an old man saying it so we can laugh at it.
I know,
so
it's the same. I mean, that's Betty White's career.
But yes,
now.
If this wasn't cut out in syndication, I'll be surprised. I did not pick up on this at the time.
Mr. Simpson?
What is it?
I couldn't help overhearing about your newfound fortune, and let me assure you that here at the Springfield Retirement Castle, money does make a difference.
Yeah?
I mean, there are rub downs, and then there are rubbed down.
Listen, you bloodsucker! Has it ever occurred to you that old folks deserve to be treated like human beings, whether they have money or not?
Yes, but it passes.
That's my line of the show.
Yeah, that's a good line.
All right, let's give that, because I didn't have one. That will be our retroactive Hank line of the show.
That's the joke.
But also, I like that in all of these clips, as someone entering upon Grandpa and him screaming.
Yeah.
And I didn't notice until I capture the clips that it all culminates with him on the roller coaster for the longest scream of all.
Right.
I miss B.
I miss you too. Oh, Abraham, calm down. I'm not here to scare you.
I do love this line.
They've got me haunting a family in Texas.
Oh.
Glad you're keeping busy.
And for the other rival joke I did not pick up on as a kid, ever until now, Homer wants to call his dad because his dad has cut him off.
I wrote that down too.
Oh, yeah. I totally missed this joke too as a kid, yeah.
I miss my daddy.
Homer, this thing with your dad has had you moping around the house for days. I think it's time for you to talk to someone who understands.
Hiya. You've reached Dr. Marvin Monroe's anxiety line. If you have a sullen teenager, press 1 now. If you're estranged from your spouse, press 2 now. If you have trouble maintaining your...
Grandpa!
There we go. Yeah.
I totally missed that.
First time I got this joke, right? Yeah, like,
never,
at least noticed
never
it.
Heard never it before. Yeah. No, and I know if you're actually listening to this, you didn't either. There's no way.
So this episode has Herman and Marvin Monroe on it. Like, it's such a season one
rogues gallery.
Yeah, it really is. I also did like the flashes of,
I like that.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, that seems very, what do you call it? Peak Simpsons.
And as they mentioned on the commentary for the Way We Was episode, the limo driver is Homer's driver from the night of his prom.
Right, just
and
a little
they
grade
aged
up.
Him up. They grade him up because it was 20 years later. That was it. Was maybe not drive. Something the writers thought of, but it was something the animators paid attention to. Which this is a David Silverman animated one, but it is like shaky. I think he mentions in the commentary that he was way overworked and he was really tired. There are moments in this of like, that's awesome David Silverman animation.
Right.
Other parts I'm like, this looks like late season one.
He made a joke essentially about like throwing a tantrum about the amount of work he had to do, and then they like, you know, allowed him to work at a more reasonable pace or with like
work. Well, yeah, because I think ongoing theme in the commentaries of The Simpsons is that the writers take the artists for granted.
Oh, for sure,
The directors who do more work than the writers, I'm just going to say it. Like, to make the animation exist, that's more work than writing an episode. Because one writer can work on every episode of the season. One animator will work on 4 episodes in season, at most. Mm-hmm. And so I can see that they're a little tired of the writers getting all the credit.
Yeah, they had to put their foot down at some point. We'll get to that episode at some point in the future. But
speaking of weird credits, though, like, just thought I'd throw that out there. The credits of this episode.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's the only time they did that, ever.
And like, they said, like, people wanted to know who did the voices, so we just gave them the information.
Yeah, like, they only did it this time. It's just like Dan Castellaneta as Homer, Abe Simpson. They list every person, each person voices.
It was a weird runoff.
Yardley Smith look like she's not trying.
The only other time they did it was on the Simpsons movie. Remember?
Oh, right.
At the end of the Simpsons movie, they showed every character too. And it actually like was a picture of the character for each voice they did.
But it's just strange.
And then when it's Lisa, it's like, it's just Lisa.
It's just Lisa. But Abe announces his intention of what he's going to do with the money.
I have an announcement to make. I've decided to give Bee's money away. There are people who really need it. I'm going to let them come to me and plead their case, and then I'll decide who needs it most.
Grandpa, that's the noblest thought that's ever been expressed at this table.
Give it us, Grandpa.
Bart!
I like that scream. Yeah, it's funny. Like, I think this would be a problem with the show much later, but in this upcoming scene, it's just like a series of characters coming in, doing their shtick,
yeah,
and then leaving. Like, the show is that confident this early that you know these characters are secondary, and here's what they do, and here's who they are. Here's 30 seconds of each one.
The lineup of characters waiting. A, there's someone dressed like Darth Vader, the Joker, and a lady Spock.
Yeah.
And then B, it's like they don't have a big enough cast of characters. They're all like one-offs from previous episodes. Miss Winthrop?
Yeah,
but it's
still specific characters, not just classy cheapo nobodies in season one.
All these mutants that were just filled the background.
It was at least like, Ken Brockman gets in line behind Principal Skinner.
The sushi chef is there.
Yeah. But the out-of-context characters is a reference to, they all went and saw, they mentioned this on so many commentaries, the writers in the first, like before the first season came out, they went and saw Batman 1989 together on premiere night. Mm-hmm. And they're like, aren't we a family? We're seeing Batman together. And the thing that got them was that at this premiere in L.A., there were guys dressed as the Joker and Batman. Fine. But they're like, why is Indiana Jones here? Why is Darth Vader here? It just confused them so much that they then put that in there. Like, just this disparate amount of people in line for no reason.
All begging for money. Well, we do get, I think this episode's only first appearance.
Definitely a first.
It's a weird first appearance, but here he is.
What the hell is that?
Why, it's a death ray, my good man. Behold.
Hey, feels warm. Kind of nice.
Well, it is just the prototype. With proper funding, I'm confident this little baby could destroy an area the size of New York City.
But I want to help people, not kill them.
Oh. Well, to be honest, the ray only has evil applications. You know, my wife will be happy. She's hated this old death ray thing from day one.
I think that's the best moment to them.
Yeah. It only has evil applications. I know that Professor Frank is a Jerry Lewis impersonation of his Nutty Professor character, but what a bizarre... He's always been like the scientist people go visit for information, not the guy pleading for a death ray. This is just a weird place to have him introduced.
It was a one-off joke of like, what if a scientist wanted a death ray?
Yeah,
okay.
I was shocked that this is his first appearance, not somewhere in a lab where someone needs like, what do you think it is, Professor?
The voice is there, but he's not doing the fake crazy like fake Yiddish.
And also, Professor Frank is named after John Frank, who was a friend of the writers who would later become a Simpsons writer himself.
Mm.
So if you see like season 12 episodes that like credit John Frank, that is the namesake of Professor Frank.
And we do have Burns making a quick appearance and the emergence of a running joke.
They don't seem to remember their time together.
Grandpa.
Calls him Grandpa.
I can call you Grandpa, can't
yeah,
I?
Yeah, go ahead.
Sure. I need that money. Please!
Wait a minute, You're the guy who owns the nuclear power plant.
Well, the ownership is divided.
What the hell do you think you're doing?
Mr. Simpson, I dread the day when $100,000 isn't worth groveling for.
Get out of here!
You've just made yourself a very powerful enemy, old man.
One thing I'm noticing is that the writers love Burns so much, they will come up with any contrived excuse to get him into an episode, which I'm
Burns
fine
shows
with.
Up. Yeah.
I feel like that's a callback for me shitting on $100,000, though. I pity the day someone doesn't grovel for $100,000.
I wonder if Burns was thinking about the tontine they both had from 1942.
But Grandpa becomes obsessed with the idea of helping people so much. This was kind of my runner-up. Because it's the funniest line delivered by a nobody character. Homer runs in to find his dad before he loses all his money and gives it away and finds out he's gone to a casino to try and gamble it to make more money to give to more poor people because he can't decide.
He's got to save the world.
A world full of problems. Where do I give this money? I'm going to have to get more before I start dealing with it. But I love the receptionist responds.
I'm looking for Abe Simpson. Mm-hmm. It's important I get a hold of him. I have to tell him I don't care about his money and I love him.
We get that a lot. Hmm. He left this morning with a senior casino junket.
Casino? Ah!
We get that a lot.
Third take as if from on the left.
As this, that's a fight that happens all the time in the retirement home.
Oh, I'm like sure, it. Yeah.
Hey, by the way, have you guys ever seen the baseball card of the guy giving the finger?
No, I meant to look into it.
So the secret is...
Oh, you can't...
So, yeah, this is how he got away with it. He is giving the finger and he's meaning to, but... It's just his hands are wrapped around the bottom, the base of the bat, and is underneath the bat. He only has one finger up, and it's only something people noticed after the cards were printed.
Like, no, I saw a different one when I was looking for this. It's just the guy whose hand is by his side, but he's clearly flipping off the camera.
Oh, there's that.
And it's
one
a
too.
1972 Detroit Tigers card with the player Billy Martin. So look that up on
Google
Search.
I know Billy Martin.
Oh, yeah. I feel like I know him too.
But there are several. Flip off like baseball cards, not just one. So I'm not sure which one they
need. I love the Major League Baseball stars are getting away with that stuff. So the Play-Doh thing, did you catch the little boys behind
Hello,
Play-Doh?
I am Play-Doh. Please partake of Keno, Craps, and the loosest slots in town. My philosophy is enjoy.
No, I totally missed that.
He says enjoy. There are several young men behind
Wow. I need to go back.
I will be capturing every Phil Hartman character from here on out, by the way, because I am continually shocked by how many. I thought I could name five. And I thought I was going deep with Smooth Jimmy Apollo. But there are a ton of Phil Hartman characters here.
Did you know what song Otto was singing on the drive there?
No.
It was Aqualung.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. We also get introduced to Springfield's Deserts.
Yeah. It's the expansion of Springfield being basically the size of five states.
And the casino is literally 1 foot over the state line.
It is. And this is another one of my favorite jokes, the last clip I have. But it doesn't play well because it's a visual joke of Homer like, I have to stop now, and then goes to a drive-thru.
Oh, yeah,
but
that is great.
I love how quickly it cuts away, and I love the drive-thru sound.
A double cheeseburger, onion rings, large strawberry shake, and for God's sakes, hurry!
$5,000 and... What century is this?
The 20th.
Great, put it on number 20.
That doesn't seem like enough food for Homer. It seems like a reasonable meal outside of maybe the giant milkshake. Maybe he just ate.
Yeah, he was like, I can't make another 2 hours on this drive without food. And then he prevents Grandpa from spending it, and then Grandpa realizes, I should just invest in the old and make them as happy as I should be.
Well, I think it's think locally kind of thing. You could try and fix all the world's problems, or you could maybe fix a few of your own and make everyone else.
When he's contemplating what to do with the money, mm-hmm. he's looking at his hands. It is one of the worst drawings. I mean, like, I guess it makes sense with the Simpsons anatomy, but he looks like he has Ninja Turtle hands.
Yeah, he does.
Like, they're literally, like, he could be holding, like, a bow staff or something.
I'm definitely handing you the picture I took of that.
Well, it's one of those things, like, you don't look too close at Homer's feet, because they have cloven hooves, but if you have to focus on them, you're like, oh, wait a minute, those aren't shoes.
It's because they have to add definition to his hands just to make him look old, and it just is not right.
I mean, poor David Silverman was told, like, and then in the script it says, and then he looks at his wrinkly hands very carefully.
I guess I have to draw this now,
Yeah, what do wrinkly hands look like in Simpsons world? Whenever I think of people being old, that's one of my first things. I'm like, oh yeah, that's what an old person would look at their hands and realize how old they are.
So we got two dead people in this episode, Phil Hartman and Audrey
All
Meadows.
Right, yeah.
As a Simpsons continuity nerd, I was annoyed that after this episode, the retirement castle goes back to a state of disrepair right after
The state of disrepair they show it in is, like, remarkably shitty.
Yeah,
like, just him walking down the hallway, the wallpaper's falling down, and...
They add a ton of extra details. Yeah. Like, I feel like all this background clutter, and that's a good thing, was a hallmark of these early episodes. Like, lots of little tiny details about how crappy the world is around them.
Does Abe own the retirement castle, or did he just give money to the people who own it?
He got some rubdowns, baby.
I don't know how he facilitated that, but it happened, and they have, like, a nice new lounge with nice recliners and dignity.
Dignity.
It's dignity, Luann!
A TV that doesn't display exclusively static.
Yeah. It was a nice... Yeah, so this was a nice episode, not one of the funniest, but...
I think it's just, like, it's a step a little too far for me now. In disassembling this show more than the person watching it would have, just thinking about who Abe Simpson is, I'm like, I'm not going to feel really bad for him. He's kind of like a fuck-up and a bad person, but...
Even to this point, we knew he was kind of he was a jerk.
Yeah, so, I mean, like, going into that without knowledge, I was like, I'm glad he found love, but this episode left me a little colder than it usually does.
Yeah,
this is nestled in a trio of episodes that I don't think work very hard.
They keep listening to the show, I know.
Don't work very well comedically, but try and tug the heart heartstrings a little too much.
I think they talk about this when we get to Lisa's substitute,
which is the best episode of all time.
But that they were worried they were getting too sentimentally. Like the, there was like the vision of writers who were like, yeah, we're just, it's fun to tell these funny jokes all the time. And then meanwhile, no, we got to do mushy family things. It's about family. Like, yeah.
So I guess that's it for us for this episode of Talking Simpsons. Yes, R.I.P. Audrey Meadows and Phil Hartman again. I guess we don't have to say that every time.
But, we don't, because he's going to appear a lot.
He's going to be around for at least the next 5 or 6 years.
Except for that awful, awful fake Troy McClure in the previous episode.
Oh, that's
not
right.
Not going to get over that.
Oh, boy. Well, they had to do that, I guess. But I've been Bob Mackey, and I still will be him when this episode's over. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. I also write for US Gamer and Something Awful. And check out my class in gaming podcast, Retronauts, at retronauts.com or usgamer.net. Thank you, everybody else. Please talk.
This is all spawned out of Laser Time. Laser Time, the weekly pop culture show. We've done tributes to David Bowie and Alan Rickman recently, to X-Files coming back, and we'll have a bunch of other stuff, so including talking about nerds, which we know nothing about.
Certainly not.
I've never even met a nerd.
There's also 30-20-10, exploration of things that happened in pop culture 30 years ago, 20 years ago, and 10 years ago. Yeah. If you like the start of this episode where we talked about what happened this week, that is covering it in length for 90 whole minutes.
The show has a finite, you know, run date. It can only run 10 years.
Yeah, you're right. It'll just repeat.
Oh my God, you got to plan for the future.
Exactly.
And there's also Cape Crisis, a comic book podcast I host every week, and a bunch of other great podcasts on lasertimepodcast.com.
Yep, that's it from us this week. We'll see you next week with a brand new episode.
Infotainment.